This conference will now be recorded.
I welcome you all to this webinar of ours, which is after a break of almost 2.5 months. We were toying with the idea of having a physical one, and it was not fair to have a physical one due to the Omicron breakout again. And people are scared of venturing out. So we've said, let us have a webinar instead of a full-fledged seminar. There was always a hope to join physically so that we meet each other after almost 20 months. Anyway, let's look on the brighter side. Very soon we'll come out physical and in the auditorium where we can interact with each other and meet all our friends under the same roof on the common platform of our KDOCA association. Without taking much of your time, let me just take the two sentences of our association. It was basically formed for imparting the knowledge, and so we have been having these seminars and webinars in the present environment. And the landmark feature of our association is the budget meeting, which is an annual feature, the flagship program we organize year after year. And God forbid everything goes well, definitely we'll have a physical budget meeting as we had in 2020 was the last one, and then the pandemic broke out. I request all the people who have not become members to please become members of the association. We have two nice speakers, the young lads from our community who are going to take the session, the young Charmik and the young dynamic Raj Khona. Without mincing much words, let me take it forward to Devang to please introduce both our speakers. Have a nice, enriching evening, one and all. Devang, please take over.
Yeah. Thank you, Ghanshyam bhai. It's my pleasure introducing CH Avik Momaya. He has cleared his ICI exams in first attempt in the year 2011. He is a partner at PRC and Company Mumbai. Chavik carries wide exposure in the field of tax audit and statutory audit with more than 10 years of experience. He has also handled special audit assignments like forensic and IFC audits. He was a convener of Ghatkopar CPE study circle in the year 2020-21. He has also delivered lectures on income tax returns, TDS provisions, finance bill, and CA practice from work from home across various forums. Kindly welcome CA Chavik Momaya. I would now introduce CA Raj Khona. CA Raj Khona is a member of ICA since 2016. He holds a bachelor degree in commerce from RA Poddar College as well as bachelor degree in law from New Law College. He has rich experience in indirect tax, especially in GST, VAT and service tax. He is an associate director at Kimji Kovaji & Company LLP and heads indirect tax GST practice of the firm. KKCA is a leading auditing firm in India with a long-standing and reputation of more than 8 decades in the market. Before joining KKCA, he has worked with one of the leading law firms in India, Lakshmi Kumaran and Sridharan Attorneys, as a member of firm's GST advisory practice for more than 3 years. He advises clients from diverse sectors on complete GST issues and is actively involved in conducting GST audits, tax compliance, reviews, due diligence, assignments, tax restructuring projects. He also handles litigation assignments and appears before tax authorities up to the tribunal. He has delivered more than 100 lectures, webinars, and talks across India. With this, let us welcome CA Raj Khona. Let us now start the session with a round of applause for Chavik and Raj. I request you all to make it interactive so that we all benefit from it. Chavik, over to you.
Thank you, Devang, for this wonderful introduction. It gives me pleasure and prestige to be speaking at KDOCA Association. I would thank the Association President and Vice President, CA Ghanshyam Lalka and CA Gautam Shah, for providing me this opportunity. Coming to our topic proper, the important aspects of tax audit report. As you all know, that there are two forms of tax audit report. One is Form 3C, Form 3CB. Form 3CA is when the audit is carried out under any other tax other than the law, and 3CB is carried out when there is no audit carried out under any other law other than income tax, and the auditor itself is the sole auditor. Along with the form 3CA and 3CB, there is an annexure of CD where all the specific information as well as general information and other information of the SSE, it has to be provided by the chartered accountant. With this brief introduction of the forms, let's begin with the agenda for today. Today we will be covering the latest circulars and notifications which are relevant for tax audit report of assessment year 2021 and 22. A brief brush upon, we will also brush upon on the due dates and penalties along with the important sections and analysis thereon. We will also have a look at the filing procedure which has been changed from current year by the new website which is coming in the form of Infosys new website. So the basic filing structure is same, the process has changed a little bit. So coming to the latest circulars, the circular number 5/2021 dated 25th March 2021, this was the first circular which was issued by the central CBDT. It is basically applicability of reporting under clause 30C and clause 44 of tax audit report. It is deferred till 31st March 2022. So this clause, again, if I'm not wrong, it was started in 2018-19, and from there on every year they are deferring these two clauses. Just to give a brief insight of these two clauses, clause number 30C is related to disclosure in respect of impermissible avoidance agreement. It relates to section 96 of the Income Tax Act, wherein a certain high value tax avoidance agreements are carried out by the entities to avoid tax, and those type of agreements which are only entered by the SSEs to avoid tax have to be disclosed in this particular clause. Obviously, materiality has to be seen. The small amounts need not be deducted. There are some thresholds, but since this is deferred, we can go ahead. Similarly, clause 44, which relates to breakup of total expenditure of entities registered or not registered under the GST, the breakup has to be given in the form of the bifurcation of the entire expenditure has to be given, whether the particular expense is in relation to goods or services which are exempt from GST, whether purchased from a composite scheme, any other registered dealers, and the total thereon. So entire summary of the expenditure was supposed to be given, the expenditure wise, but again this has been deferred till 31st March 2022. In this regard, sooner or later the clients, the SSEs as well as the CAs, will have to be geared up to maintain this information in their accounting software so that the breakup and everything is readily available. We can ask the clients to start maintaining this kind of data so that the transition becomes smoother when it is actually implemented. Second is the notification number 28/2021. It had come on 1st April 2021 itself. One of the better thing in last couple of years is at least they are notifying the forms as well as the changes quite ahead. They are not taking their sweet own time to do the changes in mid of the year or mid of the exercise when half of our audit reports are completed. No doubt this website issues and the issuance of actual forms are deferred. To that extent they are a little bit slow, but hopefully next year this anomalies will be solved. So coming back to this notification number 28/2021 dated 1st April, there were few revisions in the format of the form because of the changes which had happened in Finance Act 2021 or some other changes related to assessment year 21-22 and thereon. So we'll just quickly glance one by one and we'll just go through them in detail again. Just to make, I would request everybody to make this session interesting. We can have a healthy debate. I am presenting my views, but certainly I am also learning. So if there are any contrary views or some additional views which we can discuss, it would be great for everybody in attendance. So the first change was now the revised tax audit report can be provided or uploaded to the income tax website, subject to certain cases which are restrictive in nature. We'll come to that a little bit later on. There are changes in clause 8A to report the exercise of option under section 115BAC and 115BAD. In previous years, the clause was amended to include 115BAA and 115BAB. Now they have added 115BAC and BAD. I'm sure everybody would be aware that these sections are 115BA is related to domestic manufacturing taxation. There was a reduced rate of 25% plus surcharge plus cess for domestic manufacturing companies. 115BAB, there was a low tax rate of newly incorporated manufacturing companies at the rate of 15% plus surcharge plus cess. 115BAC, the new scheme or the liberalized scheme for individual and HUF with liberalized and multiple slabs as compared to current year. And 115BAD, again, a liberalized taxation scheme for cooperative societies. So to incorporate the decision of SS is what they are selecting, this amendment is done. There has been a change in section 43CA and section 56210, which consequently, the clause 17 of Form 3CD is amended. Subject to certain conditions and for a particular time period, the safe harbor rules of earlier 5 or 10% as the case may be, have been increased to 20% for certain cases for a limited period of time. In Finance Act 2021, they have categorically removed the depreciation component on goodwill. This was done basically to change or to reverse the decisions of Apex Court where the depreciation on goodwill was allowed. So they have brought the change, and we can, if we had read the memorandum of the Finance Act, they have given a good commentary on why the changes were done. So to incorporate that change, again, the clause 18 of Form 3CD has been amended to that extent. If the SSC is taking an option of 115BAC and BAD, again there is a there are some restrictions in brought forward losses and many deductions which are available to the SSC. To incorporate the impact of brought forward losses, clause 32 of Form 3CD has been changed. Dividend distribution tax was omitted in previous year. So the clause 36, which was related to providing the information of DDT dividend declared, taxes paid on that particular dividend, the dividend distribution tax has been omitted. So coming to all these changes one by one. First of all, rule 6G. In rule 6G, a new subrule 3 was added to incorporate the first amendment, that is revision of tax audit in certain cases. I'll just go through the subrule. The report of audit furnished under this rule may be revised by the person by getting revised report of the audit from an accountant duly signed verified by such accountant. So suppose if there is any change which is allowed, which will come subsequently, first of all, if the original return is filed, and if you want to revise the return, we have to get the revised return duly attested and signed by a CA, and then we can upload it to the income tax website. The time limit is before the end of the relevant assessment year for which the report pertains. The condition is only if there are two changes, that is the payment by such person after furnishing of report under subrule 1 and 2, which necessitates recalculation of disallowance under section 40 or 43B. So if we can break up the entire subrule, section 40 disallowances and section 43 disallowances. Section 40 disallowances is mainly related to income tax disallowances on non-payment or non-deduction of TDS, tax deducted at source. So in that there are two parts. One is on account of non-resident and on account of resident. On non-resident non-deduction of TDS, the entire amount gets disallowed in the computation of income. In case of 40IA, AIA, the 30% of the amount on which the tax is not deducted has to be disallowed in the income tax return. In section 43B, obviously there are many payments which have to be done before filing of income tax return or the due date of income tax return. That is any duties, taxes or cess which is paid, contribution to employer's contribution to any provident fund or gratuity fund. When you have paid 36(1) subclause 2, that is when any amount has to be paid to an employee as bonus or commission of services rendered. In case any interest or loan on loan has to be repaid to any financial institution, banks or NBFCs, as well as the leave encashment credits which are payable to the employees. The deduction of all these payments will be available only if it is paid before the due date or the return filing date of that particular assessment year. So typically what used to happen earlier was, earlier also this criteria was happening. Suppose we file the tax audit report a little bit earlier before filing of due date of income tax return, and the client has subsequently paid his taxes, let's say TDS or any GST or any other liability. So in the computation, we disallowed only the reduced part of the disallowances. So there was a case arising where the tax audit report, there was a disallowance of let's say 1 lakh, and the disallowances in income tax return was a little bit lower amount, let's say 60,000. So in this anomaly, there used to be notices, which again, we had to give a reply in the form of explanations and workings, and the matter had to be resolved. So now for these two particular disallowances, they have given an option to revise the audit report if the payment has been done. And this will be now common in coming years and current year also, because now the due date is the due date of tax audit is 1 month before the due date of income tax return. So there will be cases where in the 1 month gap, there will be payment of taxes or any other liabilities in section 40 or section 43B. So one question will arise is whether any other changes, either due to omission or error, can be rectified by way of revision of this audit report. Since this is an inclusive restrictive clause, I think for any other changes, it is not possible to revise the return report. And we can use this revision only for these two particular sections only. We have to take note of that. Earlier in income tax portal, there was an option to file a rectified or revised report by giving reasons. For example, one of the reason was if in AGM, the accounts are not passed and there is a revision in accounts. So by taking a clue of that, the tax audit report can be revised and it can be re-uploaded. But now I think according to me, only these two cases, tax audit reports can be revised and uploaded. So to again, to make the changes of above mentioned clauses, the clause A has been substituted to give the option to select what the SSC has opted for taxation. Again, in part B, clause 17, clause 18 CA and 32 has been amended, which are related to above 15115 BAC and 115 BAD sections. Clause 36 has been removed, that is related to the dividend distribution tax. So coming to clauses one by one, what I have done is I have just pasted the sections before amendment and after amendment. So in case of clause 17 of part B of form 3CD, we have to provide whether any land or building or both transferred during the previous year for a consideration less than the value adopted or assessed or assessable by any authority of a state government referred in 43CA or 50C. Earlier, the details of the property along with the entire details had to be provided. Along with that, consideration received or accrued, the amount had to be provided, and the value adopted or assessed or assessable by the stamp duty valuation had to be provided. After amendment, they have just added a proviso, provisions of second proviso to subsection 1 of 43CA or fourth proviso to clause 10 of subsection 2 of 56 is applicable or not. So before, this is a yes or no question. So before understanding what we have to put over here, we can just go through the second proviso to subsection 1 of 43CA. As we had earlier discussed that, 43CA is basically the safe harbor rules provides that if the difference between the agreement value and the stamp duty value is not more than 110%, then there is no adjustment to be given for section 50C or 43C as the case may be. So 43CA is basically for business income, and the 50C is related to capital gains taxation, but both are more or less one of the same. They are mirror sections. So what it says is the provision, the words 110% will be substituted by the word 120% if the following conditions are satisfied. It is a very restrictive section. So if the three conditions are satisfied, then only we can assume 120% safe harbor rules. So for the first condition is the transfer of such residential unit takes place between 12th day of November 2020 and ending on 30th June 2021. So basically, due to the COVID impact, there were many transactions which were done at a very low price as compared to the stamp duty valuations. So to give a relaxation on those transactions, this clause has been added. Second is such transfer is by way of the first time allotment of residential unit to any person. So these transaction, this amendment is only applicable to sale of residential flats only, and that too from builder to the first time buyer. So if the flat agreement is between person X to person Y, this clause, this proviso is not applicable. Third, and most important for cities like Mumbai, the transfer amount should not be more than 2 crore rupees. So kind of affordable housing is covered over here. The only problem that I feel is a COVID period was there from 1st April onwards. So ideally this amendment or the relaxation could have been given from 1st April 2021 instead of 12th November of 2020. And consequently, this is from the seller side. Consequently, there is a fourth proviso to section 56.2.10 where it says the 10% has to be substituted by 20%. Again, a mirror change of that 43CA. So again, coming back to the form, we are aware that the clause 17 has to be provided in case of a seller, and the clause is asking a section related to fourth subsection fourth proviso of 56.2.10 also, but 56.2.10 is from the angle of the buyer, and the transfer details has to be given from the view of the seller. So again, I am not sure why they have given. Maybe in case of buyer also, we have to give this information. That is what I can assess. But according to me, we have to give only the seller information and not for purchase of any property. So coming ahead to clause 18. In clause 18, there has been two changes. Adjustment made to the written down value under section 115 BAC PAD for assessment year 21-22 only. Basically, the in case of 115 BAC or 115 BAD, as you are aware, additional depreciation, for example, is not available to the SEC. So any additional depreciation which was taken has to be reversed, and that's why the clause has been added. Goodwill, we cannot take goodwill depreciation as well as the value of the goodwill. The WDV of the goodwill as on 1st April 2000 assessment 20 has to be removed from the block of assets, and hence there is an additional column which is provided, CB, that is adjustment made to written down value of intangible asset due to excluding the value of goodwill of a business or a profession. And accordingly, due to these two changes, there is a separate column that is adjusted written down value. Similarly, because of 115 BAC and BAD, the nomenclature of this particular column 6 has been changed. Earlier, for giving the details of brought forward loss or depreciation allowance, we had to give the assessment year, nature of loss, whether it is business loss, capital gains, or depreciation loss, the amount as per returns. Then the allowances which were not allowable under 115 BAA, it was there earlier also, and the amount of withdrawal or additional depreciation on account of 115 BAA, and the amount as assessed, and the remarks column. So now, instead of 115 BAA, they have added 115 BAC and BAD also. So this is procedural change, but we have to take care these columns have been added, and if there is any, if these clauses are applicable to the SEC, we have to take care in punching the data. Since the dividend distribution tax has been removed, the entire clause which was related to information of DDT has been removed, has been omitted. These are the brief changes which are there in tax audit report. While the notification and circular stated 1st April and the 25th March, we can just go through the new process of filing of Form 3C and Form 3CD. As you are aware, friends, earlier, long back, the form was used to be filed manually, and the entire form had to be submitted along with the balance sheet and income tax return acknowledgement to the department physically before the date. Then gradually the forms were changed. It was brought online, so all the data had to be filled online and uploaded online before the due date and accepted by the SEC. So that process has been continued. The only thing is there has been change in a little bit change in the process. Some few steps have been added. And just to give a brief idea about that, we can just have a look at the e-filing process. I have provided the link for the process. You can click on that link and you can directly go to the website. The process, entire process has been given in form 3CA, 3CD, income tax helpline. We can just run through that. But they have started with the process of assigning the form to a CA. I'm sure earlier, you might be remembering the earlier process. First, from the SSC's login, the SSC will assign a CA for that particular year. After that, the client, the chartered accountant will log in from his professional login. He will upload the forms. He will select the PAN number and the year and the form, upload along with the scanned balance sheet, P&L, and other audit reports, upload the documents. And again, the SSC will accept the form along with his digital signature. So similar process is there for current new website also. The only thing is there have been some additions which we have to take care before we go to filing the forms, and this additional process is one time activity and it is independent to filing of forms. So it is better that we can assign some resources from our company, and for all the audit cases we can do this information. So first of all, from the SSS login we have to go to his profile and we have to add a particular in case of firms or a company, a particular signing partner or a signatory. So there are two things. One is signing partner and one is principal contact. Both are separate tabs and both have to be filled separately. We have to fill up his PAN, phone number, email ID, and give all the details thereon. We have to update the DSC of that particular partner. But in case of individuals, the DSC or HUF, the DSC can be updated from the same login. But in case of partnership firms or company, we have to go to the individual income tax login of that particular partner or a director, update his DSC from over there, and then only we can proceed for filing of returns of a company. So earlier, the process was we can update the DSC directly on the company or firm's website and not from the individual login website. Similarly, for CA login, earlier the DSC registration was done from the professional login of a CA. Now the DSC registration has to be done from his individual income tax login. So this might create some hassles where the director is filing his returns either on his own or from some other consultant. The coordination has to be done well before the due date so that the last moment hassles are not there. And one thing, as you might be aware, that similar to EM signer of GST, now Income Tax has introduced a concept of EM Bridge. After installing that software only, we can file those income tax returns and tax audit returns also. So after doing all this process, we can log into Income Tax portal. In that, we have to go to Income Tax Forms, file Income Tax Return, file Income Tax Forms, sorry. We have to select Form 3C and 3CD. And then we have to assign whether this is an original form or a revised form, select the assessment year, CA name, and if the audit report is already signed, we can provide the scanned copy of the audit report, attach it, and continue. The CA will be assigned. And in case tax audit reports were already signed in earlier years by a particular CA, we need not add a new CA, but we have to select. He will be already added as a new CA, but we have to merely select only the forms which he will be filing. So it can be either form 3CA, 3CB, along with 3CD or 3CEB in case of transfer pricing. We have to, or 10B, or as the case may be, for each forms we have to select each and every time. So after that, we can go to the CA's login, the professional login. In that, there will be a worklist provided. In the worklist, all the names of the SACs along with the PAN number and the forms which are to be uploaded and assigned to the particular CA will be shown over here. We have to select accept or reject in each of the cases. And if we select reject, they will ask you for a reason. Why are you rejecting? We have to provide the reasons. If we accept, then a separate window will be open. And we have to again go back to the worklist, and then there will be an option enabled, file form. So once that option is enabled, we can upload the filled form, the pre-filled JSON. Earlier there was XML type. Now the data type is JSON files. Upload the JSON file. It will process the file. Then it will show whether there are any errors or not. We have to attach the supporting documents, that is balance sheet, profit and loss account, any other audit reports or any disclosures as the case may be. Press the submit button. It will show a window where we have to put unique DIN number. But as of now, this feature has not been enabled. So by default, a tab will be clicked that provide UDIN later on. So we have to remember that UDIN has to be provided later on. So that data we have to keep in mind. So once that successfully, once the form is successfully submitted, both the SSEs and the CA will get an email verification. Once that is done, the taxpayer can go to his login ID. On the dashboard, there will be a pending action menu and we have to select worklist. Again, all the pending worklist, that is what forms he has to accept, that will be shown. The data provided by the CA will be shown over here. We have to select accept or reject. Again, if we select reject, we have to provide the reason and accept along with the attaching DSC. A new bar will come that the form has been accepted and now it is in process. So little bit the process is same, but the steps have increased. So we can plan we can plan how to attach the DSCs, or we can just complete the entire DSC process one shot, so that when we are actually filing our 3CD, we do not face any unexpected errors or setbacks. And this process is sometimes it takes time. For example, there are cases where the SSE has already assigned a CA, but in the CA login, we are not able to see the assigned form. We have to wait for 2 or 3 days, then it will come. So all these practical difficulties are there. Even the other way around, when the CA has uploaded his form, we are not able to see the form immediately in SSE's portal, and hence we have to again keep on refreshing or wait to get the data enabled. You might have faced similar difficulties while filing income tax returns. Income tax returns are filed, OTPs are also verified, but the acknowledgement or the form is sometimes not available for immediate downloading. Maybe we have to wait for some time, maybe a few hours or a few days to get that information. So that's why it would be best that we can complete our tax audit in a faster manner. We should not wait for due dates, because all these practical difficulties will come and our blood pressure will increase. Coming to due date and penalty, quickly we'll brush upon this. I think the time is a little bit less, so I'll just go on a bit quickly. The time limit was extended on 9th September 2021. Again, they have not waited for the last date. The transfer pricing cases due date is now 31st January, and the any other audit case, it is 15 Jan. And correspondingly, the income tax returns have to be filed 1 month after that. The penalty is lower of 0.5% of total sales turnover or 1.5 lakhs, whichever is lower. The only issue is, can it be avoided? There are some judgments, court judgments and as well as tribunal judgments, where the penalty was avoided if there is any circumstances which is not in the hands of the SSE or the CA and the report got delayed. So in those circumstances, we can ask for the reduction in penalty or waiver of penalty, and normally it is possible. We will just quickly brush upon some important sections. First, every year there is a change in the taxability of the applicability of audit. So the audit section is 44AB. And first of all, we have to select in clause 8 under which clause or sub clause it is applicable. So there are five options: A, B, C, D, and E. First, we'll quickly see C, D, and E. Basically, they are applicable in case there is a violation of presumptive income norms. And suppose if you are not following the norms, or you are not covered under the benefits of 44AD, AE, or ADA as the case may be. Let's say the profit criteria of 6 or 8% or 50%, or the transporters, in case of transporters, 7,500 per truck per month income, and your income is more than the basic exemption limit, then audit has to be done under 44AB. Then the normal provision of in case of business having a turnover of 1 crore, during the previous year or a profession having turnover of 50 lakhs, then the audit is compulsory. There is an additional proviso, obviously, that if the cash payment or receipt is 5% of the total receipts, including the capital receipts. I'm sure you might have attended many webinars or have read many journals related to this. Then in that case, the turnover limit will be from 1 to 10 crores. Just a reminder that bearer check is at par with cash transaction. So if the SSA has issued a bearer check, it will be considered as cash transaction for that 5% criteria. As an auditor, no doubt it is very difficult because the SSC may not maintain the bearer checks. We have to take care, media may write the observation column of Form 3C or 3CB as the case may be, and we can go ahead with the audit. If in all the five clauses, if the SSC is applicable, then the tax audit is applicable and obviously form has to be filed before the prescribed date. Section 44A, that is clause 11, there are some professionals for which a required set of accounts has to be maintained even though they are getting covered in 44ADA. For 44ADA, it is prescribing which kind of books or accounts we have to disclose to the income tax authorities, but 44A is compulsory maintaining of books in case of these professionals, that is legal, medical engineering, architect, professional, accountancy, chartered accountants, technical consultancy, or interior decoration. In addition to that, there are some notified professionals by CBDT, authorized representatives of in-law, film artists. It is a very wide list. Film artists can be anywhere from an actor to a spot boy, company secretary, and information technology professionals. So there is a rule 6F where books of accounts has to be maintained. For example, for doctors, there are some specified accounts which have to be maintained, the inventory of medicines, the list of patients, etc. And in consequently, in Form 3CD, in clause 11A, B and C, we have to give whether the books of accounts are prescribed, what is and which, at which location they are available. It can be at one branch or at multiple locations. We have to mention every all the information and the list of documents which you have examined. Due to the COVID period, there is a possibility that you may not have verified the entire thing. A suitable disclosure can be given in the observations column. This is one particular section. But clause 15, that is conversion of capital asset into stock interest. Normally, the tax professional.
Chavik?
Yeah.
I have got one question, Chavik. Sorry for disturbing you.
Yeah.
Now, you were talking about the observation to be given when you're not examined all the books available. So the observation goes in the form 3CA and 3CB?
Yes.
Or elsewhere.
3CA and 3CB, there are two options available, observations and qualifications. So in observations, we can give a list. Actually, I was going to cover it subsequently, but we can just have a discussion now only.
Okay, or you carry it forward, no problem, when we see it later.
No, it's fine. Normally, what we can do is all the observations which are related to the methodology which we have conducted the audit, for example, test check basis, or there are any key notes which have to be given related to any clauses. Since the clauses are now in electrical form and they are only accepting, let's say, numericals in few many cases, we are not able to give our observations. All those observations has to be provided in that form 3CA or 3CB observations table. It is better because it gives a clarity of what audit we have done, what disclosures we are maintaining from the client, what test check we have done, and what disclaimers we are giving. For one of the simple cases, in one of the clauses, we have to give what is the personal expenses, which is debited to P&L account. It is highly impossible that we can find out all the personal expenses. So all such disclosures, or another disclosures is the bearer check one. In 269 SST or SS and 269 SST or any other clauses, it is highly impossible to check whether the check, banking check, was a cross check or a bearer check. So all those disclaimers we can provide, because nowadays anyways income tax, if there is any issue, they are catching hold of accountants. So we should be clear in our disclaimers also. One of the other thing is, there are some accounting standards which are applicable to SMEs and issued by ICAI. If those accounting standards are not maintained by the SSE, then those disclaimers also we can give. One of the simple example is, if deferred tax provisions or current tax provision is not done in P&L account, we can mention that the SSE has not created provision for income tax for that particular assessment year. So moving ahead, clause 15, conversion of capital asset into stock in trade. This is normally a typical case of land developers or builders, where they are holding a particular set of land or an asset, capital asset, and in subsequently they start a development in this project. So they convert all the capital asset into a stock in trade, that is inventory, and then use it for creating that particular project. So in that, or there is a second common example is, suppose if there are many investments of in a particular SSE which are shown as capital assets, and subsequently they are used for trading of shares, he will convert that capital asset into an inventory, and then he will show it as a sale or a purchase of, or normal transactions. So in these cases, there are two step taxation which is there. One is when the capital asset is converted into stock in trade, the fair value of that on the date of conversion will be treated as full value of consideration for the purpose of capital gains, and the amount which is on which the asset is actually sold less the fair market value, which is shown as the full value of consideration in capital gains, will be the cost for business calculations, business income calculations, and the taxation will happen. The only thing we have to take care is, both the taxes will be applicable only on the actual sale of that particular asset. However, we have to give the information in Form 3CD when there is a transfer from capital asset to inventory. So sale, actual sale might happen 2 or 3 years down the line, for example, but we have to report it in current assessment year. However, suppose if we have sold, let's say, a particular property, and for saving capital gains, we are doing some investments in, let's say, 54F, 54EC, that investment has to be done as per those particular section and rules. The time limit will remain the same. That is 6 months from the date of transfer, for example, for 54EC bonds. So this clause, there are chances that sometimes we may miss, but we have to take care. There is one clause 16, where we have to give amount not credited to the profit and loss account. The others are self-explanatory, but the only thing is, item falling within the scope of section 28, and specifically I thought that we can discuss 28.4, value of any benefit or perquisite received by the client not credited to P&L account. It might be non-monetary in nature. Those all perquisites has to be added in this particular clause. One of the common example is, there are freebies which are given by the pharma companies to the doctors, even though it may not be in this, they are not supposed to take, but suppose they are receiving any freebies or any benefits in this arrangement, or any SSC getting any indirect benefit, non-monetary benefits, and not credited to P&L account, the amount has to be derived and the information has to be given in Form 16A. At this moment, I thought we can discuss a very recent amendment, sorry, recent case law related to section 37(1). That is, if the pharma companies are giving freebies to doctors or various consultants, whether the expenditure is will be allowed as a deduction or not. This is a recent case between DCIIT Central Circle 24 Mumbai versus McLeod's Pharmaceuticals Limited, 14th October 2021. So basically, the tribunal has recommended the constitution of a bench of three or more members to consider the question whether this item is an expenditure or not. So the result is awaited. Because as per Indian Medical Council, the professional conduct, ethics and etiquettes similar to our code of ethics, doctors are also bound by it. And hence whether they can claim as a deduction. But they have also referred a case of DCIIT versus PHL Pharma Private Limited, wherein it was concluded that the freebies is not a gift given to the doctors, but it is merely a marketing or a branding tool which is done by the pharma companies to increase their revenue, and hence as such this is not contrary to the code of conduct of Indian Medical Council, and hence it is an allowable expenditure. So based on the fact of the cases and of the particular SSC, we can take use of this case laws also.
Charvik, one point for discussion.
Yeah.
Now, supposing a doctor gives a freebies further down the line, will this circular come into play? It's just a point for our academic interest. And I had a case on the similar lines.
Okay. So again, if we can elaborate a little bit more, we can come to some conclusions. Or you can share your thoughts.
Okay. See, sharing my thoughts or sharing my experience. See, I'd come across a case. It was an appeal matter in which there were doctors. It was a case of a doctor, a medical practitioner, who had debited gifts and compliments in the books, whereby he says that I have given it to my staff, I have given it to my patients, and that was his explanation. So will that fall under Section 37(1), or it will be defeated by this circular which talks about the disallowance of the freebies, is the point for our discussion and debate.
If that particular activity is debarred from IMC code of conduct, then it cannot be allowed as deduction. That is my thinking. Otherwise it can be allowed if we can treat it as business promotion.
Okay. So maybe we carry it forward and have a discussion later on also about this point.
Definitely, sir.
Yeah. Okay.
Clause 17, we have already discussed the 43CA, safe harbor rules for a limited period of time. Clause 18, whether any adjustment to computation of income on optimum of provision, that is additional depreciation, whether it is reversed, that has been done or not, has to be given. One important thing in clause 20, that is 36(1)(5)(a), over there we have to give the information of employee's contribution to any fund. Let's say Provident Fund, PF, ESIC, or any other fund. So over there, earlier what used to happen is, even though the payment is done after the due date, but there was no deduction because it was on the onus of the assessing officer to disallow that. For last 3 or 4 years, in 143(1) intimation, this information directly they used to disallow, and they were asked. We were asked to pay the differential tax amount. There were litigations where some of the judgments they allowed the deduction, or in some cases the disallowances were allowed. So to rest all this debate, the income tax is now clear. Okay, all this any amount which is paid after the due date and it is related to employer's contribution, that has to be disallowed even though it is paid before the due date of filing of 139-1. So maybe for two or three cases where people were misusing this provision, the entire community or the business community is suffering. But non-compliance of TDS provisions, majority of them are aware if the TDS or TCS is not deducted or collected as the case may be, the disallowances are there. One of the case which comes to my mind and what will be the consequences, I'm still not clear, is in, let's say, in some of the big companies, there is a estimate of all the expenses as on the year end based on the management estimations. A provision is created for a particular expense, let's say 10 lakhs. And suppose the supplier has completed that, but on that 10 lakhs, 1 lakh, let's say TDS is deducted and paid and returns have also filed. Subsequently, after March, let's say 2 or 3 months, the work is completed and the actual bill amount provided by the supplier is 8 lakhs. So in his 26 years, the amount will be shown as 10 lakhs and 1 lakh. In the bill amount is 8 lakhs and 80,000 TDS on it. So obviously the supplier will come to the company to revise the TDS returns because that extra 2 lakhs is obviously not his income. So the company is, what the company is doing is, it is revising the returns subsequently after all the tax audit and everything is done, or rather after, not after the tax audit, but before tax audit, but after the accounts are signed. And it is showing in TDS returns, 8 lakhs as the amount paid or credited to 80,000 as TDS, 20,000 as carry forward and utilizing in next year. So the ultimately what will happen is in the PNL, the amount of expense is 10 lakhs. In the TDS returns, it is 8 lakhs. In accounts, now as per TDS returns, the TDS deducted is only 80,000 instead of 1 lakh. So the difference 2 lakhs, what should be done? Whether there should be a disallowance of 2 lakhs or whether this disallowance will not happen because this is merely a provision or an estimate and these amounts will change. So aggressive view, maybe there is no disallowance. If you take a holistic view, then the PNL is obviously more by 2 lakhs and hence there should be a disallowance. And in the next year, when the provision is reversed, the disallowance will also get reversed. So suggestions are welcome. What can be the view? Maybe we can put it in chat box. Next is section 40A3, cash expenses about 10,000 is not deductible. The only highlight is everybody is aware that for few of the expenses, this case clause is not applicable. In suppose in COVID cases or in non-COVID cases also, if there is a deputation of a particular employee by the company for a continuous period of 15 days or more in a place other than his normal place of duty, suppose an engineer is going to very remote places of India for 15 days or more or on a ship, and in that particular remote area, the bank is not available, then his cash salary can be paid in cash and there will be no disallowances. Again, an important section, section 269 SS, that is clause 31. As you are aware that no person shall take or accept from any other person rupees 20,000 or more, taking or accepting loans, unsecured, secured from non-banking entities, deposits and specified sums. Specified sum is basically purchase or sale of property related amounts. The only exception is government and banking company. If the payment or amount is received from them, there is no contravention of this section. The only thing we can take in our mind is that if the payer and payee both have only agriculture income, then this particular limit of 2000 is not applicable. But again, his income, there, even if there is any savings bank interest, then according to me, this exception is not applicable and he will be covered under 216SS or T as the case may be. Similarly, the new section was there for 2 or 3 years, 269ST. No person shall receive 2 lakhs or more in cash from a person in a day in respect of a particular single transaction or an event or an occasion. Again, the exception is if a government or a banking company is receiving 2 lakhs or more in cash, they are not applicable. We have to take care of these sections and we have to sensitize our SACs because the penalties are very high in these sections. It is 100% of the amount involved. So suppose a loan of 1 lakh is taken, the penalty is equal to 1 lakh. Cost audit, again, sometimes we miss the reporting of this particular section, that is clause applicability of cost audit, clause 37. Cost audit is applicable to regulated employee sectors like power, telecommunication, etc., and their overall turnover and the product and the particular product which is covered under cost audit is more than 25 crores. There are some non-regulated sectors which are notified by the CBDT. There are some 33 businesses. If their overall turnover of is 100 crores and that specified product or services which is covered under cost audit is more than 35 crores, then also they have to conduct a cost audit by a competent person. And as a tax audit auditor, we have to report the details of that cost audit and whether any remarks are there in the report or not. Findings of the report has to be highlighted in our tax audit report. Earlier, in pre-GST era, in case of SACs which are covered under excise, we had to give the details of CENVAT or MODVAT, as the case may be. In earlier, it was MODVAT, then it got converted to CENVAT. The movement of those credits which we had taken, the opening balance of that credit, credit availed, utilized, and the closing balance and its treatment in P&L or balance sheet. After GST, there was a confusion that whether the GST can be considered as CENVAT or not. Then the form is now amended. Specifically, they have added the words input tax credit, and hence now the GST ITC, which is availed by the availed, utilized by the SAC, has to be given. The only thing we can take care is the amount should match with the financials, and if the amount is different from the ITC ledger balance as per GST records, we can keep a reconciliation handy for our working purposes. Or the other way the SAC can do is the amount which is matching with the credit balance, it can be shown separately, and the unreconciled balances, either due to ITC which is taken later on or not, or disallowances are there, that can be shown separately in our balance sheet. One of the most important section in tax audit report, that is TDS and TCS provisions. The entire deduction or collection of taxes by a particular SAC, the entire details have to be given section wise. And if the client has multiple TAN numbers, it has to be bifurcated multiple TAN number wise. We have to give the entire details whether TDS is deducted or not. Even in case the deduction is not applicable, we have to give the amount where due to exemption or otherwise, the amount of expenditure which is done. For example, in case of professional fees, there is a exemption limit of 30,000. So there will be cases where the professional fees of particular suppliers are less than 30,000. So that amount has to be included in the fourth column. Out of that, the amount which on which TDS is was deductible and deducted, we have to give along with the TDS amount or TCS amount. And in case there is a short deduction or no deduction, in column number 9 and 10 we have to provide. The only thing we have to take care is the entire amounts has to be properly mapped with the respective expenses, income, or let's say capital expenses, so that the entire table is matching with whatever figures we are giving in our financials. Similarly, we have to give the due dates. There are multiple due date changes in AY21-22, so we have to prepare a proper chart for that. The date of furnishing and whether all the information was properly done or not. We sometimes miss few details that the TDS is deducted in accounts, it is paid also, but sometimes it is not properly reflected in the returns. So sometimes by oversight or by otherwise, this information is missed. We as an auditor, we can also miss to check that information. We have to just make sure that the amounts as well as the non-numerical disclosures like PAN number and etc. are proper or not. Otherwise, we have to report in this particular column. Again, if there is any interest payable for any deductions related to assessment year 21-22, whether it is paid or not, we have to give the information, and we have to take care that the entire information has to be given for AY 2021 and 22. For example, if the TDS is paid in subsequent year, financial year 21-22, then also we have to report the interest payments in this year only and not the next year. And conversely, if any previous year's interest is paid in current year, then also we need not report according to me. There was a pronouncement, but I think I just summarize in 2 minutes. There was a ITAT bench judgment, K Raija Corp Private Limited versus DCIT Mumbai. I think this is also a recent judgment of 2021, wherein on lease assets, the company was into the business of leasing assets to other companies, properties to other companies, and along with that, they were leasing furniture or office equipments, etc. So they were collecting additional rent on those assets. If I'm not wrong, in assessment year 12-13, they missed to take depreciation on that particular equipments or furniture assets which were being on lease. So that is lease assets. Even in tax audit, it was not the amount was not provided in ITR also, that depreciation was not claimed. However, in the next year, the auditor had adjusted the opening balances of the particular WDV, took the depreciation, and the SSE had also claimed on in their computation of income. The assessing officer obviously had not allowed this particular practice, but subsequently at tribunal IDAT level, it was allowed. So the only question is whether we can, if any amounts are missed in either tax audit or computation of income, whether we can take note of this judgment and we can claim those deductions in next year. That is a food for thought that I'll leave you with. That's all for today. Sorry, I think I have extended my time a little bit. And any questions? I guess there are no questions. So maybe I request CA Raj Kona to continue with his presentation.
Charvik, it is said that when the session is very good, there are not going to be any questions.
It can be other way around also.
Raj can take over. Raj has the same tempo. Yeah.
So I am just sharing my screen. So is the screen visible?
Yes.
Okay. So first of all, thank you to the association, the president, all the office bearers for giving this opportunity to me. The topic which has been given to me is a very interesting topic and a very evergreen topic, because GST notices, service tax notices, we receive every day, or our clients are receiving, and we have to deal with such issues on a regular basis. And the second part of this topic is on the GST amendments, And that also is a very interesting topic because we might be discussing this and there might be a notification or a circular being issued by CBIC, the Central Board of Indirect Taxes and Customs. So that amendments are so fast that what we discuss in the session now, it might change after this session. So this is also a very interesting topic, amendments. So the agenda is to discuss the legal provisions which are related to the GST notices and service tax. So briefly, that I'll touch upon those provisions so that all of us are on the same page. And then once that is discussed, we can I'll be taking up the some issues which I feel needs to be discussed with regard to these notices. I'm not going to discuss everything in very detail because of the shortage of time, but I'll see to it that I cover all the broader aspects of these provisions. And what should be then discuss the suggested approach in handling the GST and service tax notices. So basically when we, because these are all high, responding to any notice is a little bit a trickier issue. It involves legal principles. We have to follow the process of law. And this is something which it is a very kind of a niche practice, which the litigation practice, which we call, which people do. So what approach normally, what we follow in handling such cases, or what is suggested approach, that I would like to discuss. And then lastly, the recent amendment circulars under GST, that would be the agenda for the discussion. Now going with the provisions under the GST with regard to the notices. So there are different types of notices which a department officer can issue. One is regarding this section 46. So what 46 says that if you have not filed the returns, GST returns, that is under section 39, then a notice can be issued within to furnish the return within 15 days. So this is a non-filer notice, which normally people receive in from 3 GST or 3A. And this notice will say that you have not filed the return. Please file the return within 15 days of receipt of this notice. This is the first thing. Now, secondly, if I don't file this return, able to move this slide. Okay, yeah. So the second is about the going forward is regarding the, suppose I don't file the return within the time limit prescribed in the notice, then the department can, the officer can pass an order, do an assessment based off his judgment, and he can pass an order saying that so much, as per whatever the information I have available with me, so much is payable according to that, and therefore he will make a demand. So that is a assessment in case of non-filers of the returns. So basically, if you look at section 62, it talks about person failing to furnish the return under section 39. And even after the service of notice under section 46, the proper officer may assess the tax to the certain person to the best of his judgment, taking into account all the relevant material which is available. So basically, this is kind of a best judgment assessment, which basically due to non-filing of the return. And this can be done within a period of 5 years from the date of filing the annual return, GST annual return. So this is a very a mechanism where the people are not actually filing the returns. To cover such cases, this provision is there. Now, suppose the person furnishes the valid return within 30 days of the service of the assessment order, then the assessment order shall be deemed to be withdrawn. But interest and penalty provision, late fee provisions will continue. So whatever the interest or late fee is there for delay in payment of the tax, that will stand. Then the next is on the next is scrutiny of returns. So this is scrutiny of returns, which is normally currently all the people are receiving the notices. All the taxpayers, all the assessees are receiving such notices based on the scrutiny of the return. So whatever the actual parameters they have designed. All the state governments have designed certain parameters. Based on those parameters, they are issuing notices. That these are the discrepancies in the returns which you have furnished and what data is available with us. So based on that, they're issuing notices. So based on a scrutiny, certain scrutiny parameters are given. In the slide, I have put this. So Maharashtra, we have these parameters. Based on these parameters, they are doing comparison. They are using data analytics and issuing notices. So system generated notices are being issued based on certain parameters, which based on the data which is available with the GST department and what you have given in the returns. So some of the parameters we have listed here. So ineligible ITC claim from non-genuine taxpayers whose RC is cancelled have been issued. So I have availed credit from some dealer whose registration has been cancelled. So then I get a notice that so much tax ITC is denied. I am not discussing whether that ITC is correctly denied or not. That is not the point of discussion of this today's topic. I am here to only elaborate what are the types of issues which for which the notices are being issued. Secondly, then excess outward tax in GSTR1 compared to GSTR3B. So they compare your tax liability as per GSTR1 and 3B, and based on that, they are issuing notices. Then the e-way bill data is also compared. So whatever is the output tax as per e-way bill is compared with GSTR3B. Similarly, ITC claimed from GST3B non-filers. So suppose I am claiming input tax credit from GSTR3B non-filers, then such notices are issued. Then your 2A and 3B mismatches. For that also it is issued. Then turnover issues with the reported with the TCS and GSTR1 or TDS, that is 3B and TDS. So all these are parameters. Reverse charge liability. So suppose in GSTR2A, my vendor has uploaded the invoice and said that tax is payable on reverse charge. But I have not paid the tax. That may be due to various reasons, but they are issuing notices based on that parameters. Then regarding interest, excess claimed in ISDE. So various parameters they have found out, and based on those parameters, they are issuing notices. So these are the parameters, 17 parameters they have given for Maharashtra GST. Based on this, the notices are being issued under Section 61. So Section 61, what it talks about that the officer may scrutinize the returns, inform the discrepancies and seek explanation. So he can basically say that, write a notice to the associate that this is the differences or mismatches I have identified based on certain parameters, that you have not paid the interest on the delayed payment of GST, or there is a mismatch between ITC as per 2A and what is you have claimed in 3B. So all such parameters, you can issue notices and you can seek explanation. So if the explanation is found to be acceptable, then there is no further action. But if there is no satisfactory explanation given in within 30 days, then he can initiate proper action as per the sections 65, 66, 67 or 73 or 74. So these are provisions related to determination of tax. So that the officer can initiate. So preliminary, normally what happens, the initial stage is a scrutiny of notice. Based on that system generated notice, he got some data from income tax, or he found some data from the GST portals, and he can compare that and issue notices to us. Then the form in which he will issue the notice is ASMT 10, and you have to reply, any associate has to reply within 30 days in ASMT 11. So there is a proper prescribed format in which the notice has to be issued, the reply has to be given. And based on that, he passes an order in ASMT 12. So based on whatever the explanation is given, that officer has to pass an order. So that is ASMT 12. Now, the question here is whether officer can issue notice under Section 61 for issues or discrepancies not forming part of the return. So if you read the section, it specifically says he can scrutinize the returns. He can scrutinize the returns. He can verify the correctness of returns and related particulars furnished by the registered taxpayer to verify the correctness of these returns and inform him the discrepancies notice. So primarily, he can only scrutinize the returns. So whatever data I have given in the returns, he can compare with the GST portal or income tax, whatever be the case. And based on that, he can issue notice. Subsequently, whatever information I give to that person, based on that, he may further dig into it, and he may issue start the investigation or the inquiries. But preliminary, he can issue notices according to me only based on the discrepancies which are forming part of the return. any discrepancy other than what is furnished in the return that is not covered under section 61. Then move to the next section, that is section 63, which talks about the assessment of unregistered persons. So suppose you have failed to obtain the registration. So suppose you are required to take registration, but you have not taken the registration. So in that case also, and it comes to the knowledge of the officer that so and so person was supposed to take registration, but he has not taken the registration. This can be based on the income tax data available with the GST department, because all the things, the GST department, income tax department, banks, then the customs, everything is interlinked. So there is sharing of data between all the departments, and based on that, they may come to know that this person is liable to take registration, but he has not taken registration. So in that case, the notice may be issued under section 64, and the assessment can be done. So, and this is again a best judgment assessment, which is possible under section 63. Then next is a summary assessment. So what is a summary assessment? Summary assessment, in that what happens that a person, the department has an some kind of an evidence that this person will evade the tax, or he may run away, or it may be to protect the interest of the revenue, they can pass an order without giving notice. Also, they can pass an order saying that so and so, this amount is payable by this person. But once this order is passed, then within 30 days of the receipt of the order, the person can approach the officers, and if the additional commissioner or JC considers such order as erroneous, then orders may be withdrawn, and the procedure given for determination of tax under 73 and 74 can be followed. So this is a summary assessment which is done in very specific cases, where as per the officer, with prior permission of the additional commissioner or joint commissioner, in order to protect the interest of the revenue, they can pass an order. And this is something very has to be used in a very cases where the stakes are high, and only in limited cases this power should be used. But these powers are given to the officer to make a summary assessment, and subsequently all the information can be furnished and all this procedure can be done. But these are some very draconian powers given to the GST authorities. The forms in which the can be given are given in this slide. You can go through this. It is all self-explanatory. So the forms are given. Now I'm moving to the very important sections, section 73 and 74. So these are the main sections under the GST, similar sections that are in the service tax. So if you look at GST, it is a mixture of all the sections. So whatever the worst was from service tax, that has been taken under GST. Whatever the worst was there under customs has been taken. Excise, that has been taken. Whatever the worst was there under VAT has been taken. So this sections, I feel it is taken from the service tax. And these are the sections which give the power to the officers to issue notices for various cases. Now, what are the cases for which the notices can be issued by the proper officer under section 73? 73 covers cases where the notices are issued for reasons other than fraud or willful misstatement or suppression of facts. So these are cases where the notices are issued for reasons other than these three. Okay, so what are the reasons? One is he has not paid the tax as per the officer, short paid the tax, he has erroneously short paid or erroneously refunded, or where the input tax rate has been wrongly availed or utilized for any reason. So as per the officer, if these reasons are there, then they can issue a notice. Now this notice can be issued. There is a time limit for issuing this notice. This notice can be issued at least 3 months prior to the time limit specified under section 10 for issuance of order. Now what is the time limit for issuance of order under this section? Is that the order for the passing the order, the time limit is 3 years from the furnishing due date of annual return. So I furnish the due date for furnishing of annual return for 2021 is supposed to say 31st December 2021. So 3 years from that, they can pass the order. So before that, at least 3 months prior to the issuance time limit, he has to issue that notice. Now this, it is possible that he may issue 15 days before that also, but that is there. So here the shall issue the notice at least 3 months prior to the time limit specified in this section. It is new. And the word uses shall. So therefore, this is a directory thing, and therefore that officer should endeavor to issue the notice at least 3 months that is specifically provided in the section. What happens if the notice is issued after the means 2 months prior to the time limit? That has to be seen. But the section specifically talks about at least 3 months prior to the time limit specified in the section subsection 10. That is for 3 years from the filing of the annual due date of filing of the annual. Now there is one more thing is that suppose I'm getting a notice for financial year 2020. And based on that, similar issues are there in 21, 22, 22, 23. So the officer may not issue a detailed show cause notice. Okay, the show cause notice is basically the opportunity is being given to the person to tell them that why tax should not be recovered from you. So it is not, it is possible that person may not issue a detailed show cause notice for same issue which is recurring in different years. So what they have given is that a statement can be issued instead of the show cause notice for the subsequent periods. Similar provisions were done under service tax also. So what will happen is that suppose in 2021 the issue is regarding the input tax credit, that so and so things are not appearing into a whatever be the case, or the person has not paid tax, etc. So same issues are repeating in the next years also, or you are not paid tax under reverse charge on some GTA service or legal service, whatever be the case, and same issues are appearing in different years. So he may not pass a detailed show cause notice, because as per the Supreme Court judgments and various circulars, that show cause notice has to be detailed. It should contain all the facts of the case, what are the legal provisions, etc. So the officer may issue a survey statement, which just does the basic calculation of whatever the tax liability as per him or what input tax credit has to be denied. Based on that statement, he can proceed. So 1 year that he can issue a detailed show cause notice. If the issues are similar, then he can issue a statement. So that is given here. So that is about the statement. Now, if the person, whatever I issue a notice, suppose I receive a notice, and before the service of the notice, normally the scrutiny will happen, and then if the scrutiny is not there, then they will go with section 73 or 74. So in during that process, he will say that I will issue a notice. So say suppose before I issue a notice, I receive a show cause notice, I have made the payment of tax, then there is no provision that then he may not issue a show cause notice because I have already paid the tax. So there is no interest, etc. And there is a specific provision in the law which says that suppose I pay the tax within 30 days from the issuance of the show cause notice, then there won't be any penalty also. So I pay tax along with interest, that is whatever the interest is applicable, within 30 days of the issuance of the show cause notice, then there is no penalty payable. So penalty is waived, straightforward. So normally we have to argue that penalty is not levable, I have not done any suppression. So they have said that if you are paying tax plus interest within 30 days of the issuance of notice, no penalty shall be payable and all proceedings in respect of the said notice shall be deemed to be concluded. So this will cover cases other than fraud, etc. So I receive a show cause notice, within 30 days I am paying the amount, then there is no penalty. So basically they have said, even if the penalty is applicable, even if the penalty is applicable as per section 132, there won't be any penalty. So this is a very welcome provision that normally people wait for a Sabka Vishwas scheme or a Vivad Se Vishwas scheme, and then they say that penalty will be waived off or interest will be waived off. Now, if you are paying the tax within 30 days from the issuance of the show cause notice, then tax plus interest you pay, penalty is waived off immediately. So, and the proceedings will be deemed to be concluded. So there will be proper conclusion of the proceedings also. So this is something very unique. Then the determination provision says that what will be payable as per this section. It says that the proper officer shall determine the tax, interest and a penalty equivalent to 10% of the tax or 10,000, whichever is higher, due to such person and issue an order. Okay, so this is something different. So the determination will be in this context, but a normal penalty under the normal provisions also will be there. So there would be double penalty if such things are there. Then this is what we discussed. The proper officer shall issue an order under section 9 within 3 years from the due date of furnishing of the annual return for the financial year. So basically, a proper officer has to pass an order within the 3 years from the due date of the furnishing of the annual return. After 3 years, the passing of order will be time barred. So, or any notice is issued. So the passing of the order time limit is given. So they have to start before. It is not that they within 3 years they have to initiate the proceedings. They have to start before. So passing of the order, the time limit is for passing of the order. Okay. Yeah. So one more thing here is regarding this penalty. It says notwithstanding anything contained in subsection 6 or subsection 8, penalty under section 9 shall be payable where any amount of self-assessed tax or any amount collected as tax has not been paid within a period of 30 days from the due date of payment. So whether penalty is mandatory, what is the question? So normally if you see whether it is income tax or sales tax, service tax, excise, customs, penalty is always discretionary. It is upon the officer to decide whether there is mens rea, or what we call in legal terms that there is a guilty mind, and whether the person has defaulted, means he has willfully defaulted, and there is a presence of mens rea, then only penalty can be levied. So whether by section 73.11, the penalty has to be paid compulsorily, that is a question. According to me, the intention of any tax law will not make any penalty mandatory. So that discretion will always be given to the officer to determine whether penalty is payable or not. But the sections are worded in such a way, and this can be used by the officers. Next is the provisions related to section 74. 74 is for the it is determination of the tax in cases where there is a fraud or willful misstatement or suppression of facts. So similar provisions are there, but here the time limits are increased. So here the notice has to be issued within a 6 months prior to the time limit. So time limit for issuance of order under section 74 is 5 years. 5 years from the filing of the annual return. And at least 6 months before the time limit of filing the order, issuance of the order, the notice has to be issued. That is the one thing. Here, if the proceedings, the scrutiny, etc., has gone, any general notice you have received, and based on general notice means a letter or kind of a communication you have received from the officer that so much is payable, or there is a provision of DRC 01, which we'll be discussing 1A, that before issuance of notice they can determine the tax and give an intimation to you. So in that case also, suppose that person has issued a note, normal notice to you that so much is payable, and you pay that amount, and it is a case of fraud, misstatement according to that person, then in that case, before issuance of notice, if you are making the payment, then penalty only will be 15% of the tax. Only 15% of the tax will be the penalty. And if you are making the payment within 30 days of the issuance of notice, then in that case, it will be 25%. So therefore, these are some provisions for early recoveries and reduction in the actual penalty. So actually, the penalty may be very high, but if you are replying within time, then the penalty will reduce. The time limit is again 5 years from the filing of the annual return, and served with an order under this section. So this is the same thing which we discussed. Then moving on to section 75, there are certain general principles which they have given for the department to follow, basically while determining the tax. One is if the order, the show cause notice or order is stayed, then period by the courts, basically the courts or tribunal has stayed the proceeding notice or issuance of order, then the period of such stay shall be excluded for the calculation of the time barring, whatever the time limit is there. So that will be excluded. Suppose as per the court order or the appellate authority or the tribunal or court, if I'm issuing, suppose the notice is issued under section 74, that is for which the time limit is 5 years, an extended period of limitation, what we call, has been invoked for fraud, willful misstatement or suppression of facts. But as per the court, there is no fraud, there is no willful misstatement or suppression. So the notice issued under section 74 will become automatically notice issued under section 73. So therefore, there will be the jurisdictions accordingly will shift. Then the next thing is the order has to be issued within 2 years from the date of communication of the direction of the tribunal or court. So any order is required to be issued in pursuance of an order of the appellate authority or appellate tribunal, then such order has to be communicated within 2 years from the date of commencement of such direction. Second, last is opportunity of being heard has to be given. That is the general principles of natural justice have to be followed in all cases. And normally the procedure is that the 3 hearings should be given. So maximum 3 hearings they have given. So no adjournment shall be granted for more than 3 times to the person during the proceedings. So 3 hearings have to be given. That is what has been provided here. Then one more specific thing which we discuss in forums, that whether the order can go beyond the grounds specified in the show cause notice. So I have received a show cause notice. In that show cause notice, 3-4 grounds are given. Now by doing the adjudication, while assessing, when I submit the reply, that the person who is adjudicating the matter, he finds out some additional grounds, and he passes an order based on the additional grounds which are not contained in the show cause notice, whether that person has the power to do that. So specifically it is given here that order cannot go beyond the grounds or amount specified in the show cause notice. So if the show cause notice is for 50 rupees, you cannot go for 100 rupees. So you cannot demand pass an order for 100 rupees. So you have to limit yourself to the show cause notice, unless you give an additional notice, whatever be the case. Next, interest is automatic. Mentioning of interest is not required. And deemed conclusion, if the order is not passed within 3 years or 5 years of the case, as the case may be. So if you are not passing the order within the time limit specified, then it is deemed that it is concluded. Okay. And self-assessment provisions are given here. Next, I move to section 73, which talks about tax collected but not paid to the government. So normally, suppose I have collected the tax from the government, but the tax was not paid from the assessee. So GST is an indirect tax. So normally it is collected by the seller from the buyer and paid to the government. So suppose I collect tax but not pay the same to the government, then irrespective of whether the supply is taxable or not, that has to be paid to the government. Suppose say I collect tax for a supply which is exempted, but still I have collected tax, I have to pay to the government. That is the provision. And if I don't pay the tax, then show cause notice can be issued for tax, interest and equal penalty. The order for these cases has to be issued within one year from the issuance of show cause notice. There is no time limit for issuance of show cause notice here. And there is no time limit for passing the order also. It is only says that the order has to be passed within 1 year from the issuance of show cause notice. So show cause notice can be issued. Normally it will be, if it is under section 76, then there is no specific time limit, but according to me, the general limitation period will apply as per the Limitation Act of 3 years. So that should apply, but here there is no specific mention of it, that the show cause notice has to be issued within a particular time limit. There is no mention of that, but order has to be issued within 1 year from the date of issuance of the notice. So that is there. So suppose the government receives the amount from me with regard to this tax, so they can adjust the tax payable, whatever, in some other case I have some tax payable, or during this case only I have some tax payable, then they can adjust it, and balance they have to give it to the SURF fund, which is created, the consumer welfare fund basically. So this was about section 76. So we have discussed section 46, 61, 62, 63 notices under this section, and 64, and 73, 74, and 76. 75 is the general principles. So these are the provisions which talks about the various notices can be issued under GST. Now we move on to the important part of it, is that the service of notice. Now this is a very unique thing under GST, that how the notice can be served. Normally, if you are looking at income tax has now changed, but earlier days, pre-GST regime, in that case, notices were issued. Basically, hard copy was received. I would say, get a notice that this is a hard copy. And based on that, I will proceed. But now with the advent of technology, so many mediums available, there they have prescribed various modes of delivering the notice. One is a physical mode, which is there here. So the section 169 talks about service of notice. But it covers any decision, order, summons, notice, or any communication under this act or rules made under shall be served by any one of the following modes. So whatever the modes are given here, any one of the mode can be used for serving of the notice. One is mode is physical mode. I can issue a copy, deliver it to that person, hand deliver or through speed post. Then one mode is through email. So whatever the email I have given at the time of registration as an authorized signatory, whatever the mail has been given, that email, on that email, the communication can be sent. So notice can be issued through email. One mode is uploading on the portal. So normally I upload on the invoice on the notice on the portal, and which is happening now, that notice come on the portal, I don't get information only. So notice is issued on the portal, and based on that, the service of notice is happening. Then publication in newspaper circulating the locality, wherever the person is there in that newspaper, the notice is, the publication of the notice is, can be done. And then if not possible, then affix a copy on the notice board of the office of the concerned officer or the office of that person where the business is done. So this is something very unique. So here the question is whether this has to be followed in a sequential format or a preferential format. So whether the officer has to go in a sequence, that first I'll go hand deliver, if not post, then email, then on portal, then on in newspaper, and then in by affixing on the notice board of that, or pasting a notice on his office premises or his associate's place of business, whether this is a sequential thing or it is a preferential thing. Here the word uses any one of the following. So basically, if you read the law, it is a preferential thing. Based on whatever the officer feels like, he can do that. But this is very draconian. I cannot go on the portal directly every day and check whether the notice is issued or not. Or I normally, people don't access the emails also. So what is happening is little bit difficult. He can issue a notice in the newspaper also, that so and so person, we are issuing notices, or this is a case, and you, I may not read the newspaper on a regular basis. So this is something which any business, when we talk of ease of doing business, something like this is becoming a roadblock in the ease of doing business. Then these are the forms. I'll quickly now go ahead with the service tax. So similar provisions, I'm not discussing the service tax in very great detail because the provisions are more or less similar. So section 73 of the Finance Act 1994 and section 74, they both cover these cases. So section 73 talks about two things. One is when the issue is related to non-payment of service tax or short payment or erroneous refunds. In that case, a notice can be issued. Two types. One is for fraud, collusion, misstatement, willful misstatement, suppression of facts, and for other than that. So when it is for other than fraud, collusion, willful misstatement, suppression of facts, the time limit for issuance of the notice is 30 days, that's 30 months, so 2.5 years. And for for fraud cases, it is 5 years. So the extended period of limitation is 5 years. Here it is show cause notice time limit and not the passing of order time limit. So this is the distinction between GST and service tax. I'm not going in detail on the provisions. I'm just put this in and how to compute that limit is from the filing of the return. So basically, whatever the service tax returns I have filed, from that the 30 months or the 5 year time limit has to be computed. Same provision, service tax collected from any person but has to be deposited. So that is also there in the service tax also. So these were the legal principles or legal provisions which are related to GST, the notices, GST law and service tax law. So this was what I wanted to discuss before I move to the actual discussion on the notices. So what are the issues? Now question arises in everyone's mind that I have transmitted or I have now transitioned to a GST regime. So whether the service tax notices which I am receiving now, whether they are legally valid. Okay, so that is the first question. So whether I can still receive notices under the GST regime for service tax cases. Suppose in 2017 service tax law was repealed or the Finance Act 19 was repealed. But whether that officer has a power to issue notices related to matters of the service tax regime under GST. So this was basically a lot of discussion has happened on this. And there is a repeal and savings provision in the GST, section 174. This talks of gives the power to the government to issue notices. But this was challenged in the courts, and the Bombay High Court in the case of JSK Marketing 2020 46 GSTL 369 has held that the government has a power to issue notices. A lot of writ petitions have been filed on this case, and I think the Supreme Court will decide on this. But normally, what the grounds, normally when I'm drafting my reply to the show cause notice, I would suggest a ground to be taken in the show cause notice that if there is no other ground, a strong ground or merits, we can take a ground that you cannot issue notices related to service tax under GST. So that is what this JSK marketing case was there. So that ground can be taken. Suppose Supreme Court rules in our favor, then it is beneficial. If it doesn't rule, then that is okay. But one ground has to be taken, because when we file a reply to the show cause notice, that we have to take the grounds. So we can take such grounds. Secondly, there is a recent instruction by the CBIC that to the officers that indiscreet show cause notice should not be issued. Proper analysis has to be done and then only issue show cause notices. So indiscreet show cause notices should be avoided. Therefore, this is instruction given by the GST department. Now, second issue is a very important and interesting issue, which normally all the tax practitioners or GST practitioners or the VAT service, whatever the case, we receive such notices for our clients, is that there is a mismatch of turnover, what is disclosed in 26AS, the income tax return, or what you have disclosed in service tax return and GST returns. So basically, this is based on the matching of the data on the government portal, income tax and GST portal. Now, there are various reasons why such notices will be issued. Though the technology has developed, the data analytics have developed, but there are different laws has different ways of disclosing the turnover. So for example, accounting standards, as per the accounting standard AS7, construction context. So I will book the revenues or account the revenues as per the accounting standards. But for GST, I may follow milestone basis as per the continuous supply of service, etc. For income tax, I may follow a different method. So there are different methods which are prescribed under different regulation for recognizing the turnover, paying tax, etc. So just basis the difference whether the notice can be issued. Practically, there are certain challenges. Now, similarly, under the GST law, there is a service tax law, there is an abatement given for restaurants or for some other service, GTA, or something else. GTA is under reverse charge, but some other like a catering thing or a restaurant or some other provisions. So abatement is given. So as per the service tax law, I will pay tax only on the abated value. But as per the income tax, I have to pay on the entire value. So there are different issues. Then suppose independent director. I had a live case wherein one independent director, he was a retired employee of a very big PSU, was a big person. And he was, after his retirement, he served on the boards of various companies. Now, what happened is that the service tax authorities were issuing notices to him that as per income tax, your turnover is so and so, but service tax, you are not filed. Now, that person is not aware that he's an independent director. Independent director, the company which pays the sitting fees to the independent director has to pay under reverse charge. But every year he was getting notices from the department that this is a mismatch in turnover and please pay service tax. Now that senior person who is 65 plus or 70 plus, that person has to go to the officer or reply to every year that I am an independent director, whatever income I receive, the company is paying under reverse charge. But now here the burden of proof is on the person who is replying that independent director. So department, based on the data available, is issuing notices without applying the mind, and people are facing such issues. So this is something which people face, and therefore very popular notices. Everyone gets these notices. So there are various judgments also under the old regime the Supreme Court judgment in the case of Farik Chand Gulati versus Uppal Agencies, 2008-12-STR-401 Supreme Court. It says that I cannot initiate recovery based on the nomenclature. Whatever nomenclature I have given in the return, that does not mean my service is taxable. I have said that so much is my income, does not mean that it is taxable. You have to look at the actual facts of the case. Just comparing the turnover and issuing notices is not correct. My transactions might be exempted entirely from GST or service tax. So just by whatever nomenclature I have given in the income tax return, I should not get a notice. Again, there is one more judgment, Kush Constructions, Allahabad Tribunal, which says that just by presumption that this is a service, based on just presumption, you cannot issue notices. So there are various judgments under the service tax regime also, which talks about that based on whatever the income tax return is filed, you cannot just issue notices under GST. And recently we have found they have issued show cause notices also. So show cause notices just based on that cannot be issued. So therefore, we need to be very careful while dealing with situation. There are tribunal judgments also, Alpha Management, Amrish, Ramchandra, Shah, Bombay High Court, various judgments are there for these issues. So whenever such notices are issued, we have to do a proper analysis of whatever the turnover we have disclosed in the service tax or GST return and compare it with the 26As or other IT return. Normally, what we follow in our office also for various of our clients is that income tax as well as the GST, that whenever they are common clients, we prepare a reconciliation at the time of filing the income tax return only. That whatever is the GST returns filed, whatever turnover is disclosed in that, that is compared with whatever is appearing in 26A's books, and whatever reconciliations are there prepared at that time only. So after 2 years, if you receive a notice and you have to do that exercise at that time, it becomes a big task. So this has to be done on a regular basis because such notices might come in future. So we have to be ready now only. The next is on the pre-consultation before issuance of the show cause notice. So this is something which the manual of the CBIC specifically says that in the service tax regime, the big cases, if the volume, the tax amount is more than 50 lakhs, then there is a mandatory requirement to do pre-consultation. So before issuance of the show cause notice, I have to consult the adjudicating authority, has to consult the assessee that so and so amount we are issuing a show cause notice, whether it is if you want to pay it off before issuance of show cause notice, you please pay it off. So normally what happens is basically under service tax, there was a concept of EA 2000 audit. So the service tax audit, the officers will come to do the audit and based on that, they may come out with the FAR and what is as per them the payable. And before issuance, if I pay before that with the based on that FAR, then it is fine. If not, then they can go with the show cause notice. But before that, a pre-consultation has to be done. That is what is given in the manual. Even under GST, there is a provision for GST department audit. So department will come and do the audit. So based on that, before issuance of show cause notice, they have to mandatorily give that. The circular number is 1053 service tax. And this has been amended later on, 1076, the GST circular. Now moving on to the next point is delivery of show cause notice by uploading on portal and giving an email notification valid. So show cause notice is issued on the portal and I just get an email notification that I have received so and so show cause notice. Now this is a very debatable issue. We have discussed this under 169, that any one mode can be used. So I upload on the portal, that is enough. So just I'm receiving an email notification that I have just received a notice from the GST department. Might be valid, but according to me, that has to be challenged. And there are various precedents wherein we can say the communication has to happen. Now, what is communication? As per the contract law, that person should know that I have received a notice. Just by uploading in the portal does not mean the communication is complete. When the communication has to be complete? So that needs to be seen, and I think with the going ahead, there would be a lot of discussion or the jurisprudence on this aspect, that what is the communication complete, whether uploading on the portal amounts to service or notice, or this is something which going ahead might take shape. Then one of the important thing is quoting of DIN. There are two circulars which says that whenever any notice, any summons, whatever is issued, there has to be computer generated DIN, document identification number, which the officer has to generate when he is issuing such documents, and that has to be mandatorily quoted on all the communication. So therefore, quoting of DIN is mandatory, except in certain exception cases, they have given some exceptions. Next point is invocation of the extended period of limitation. Now, this is a very debated topic, extended period of limitation. So normally what is extended period of limitation is that increasing the time limit, 3 years to 5 years or two and a half months to say five years. So there have been various judgments on what is fraud, what is suppression, what is willful misstatement. These points have been argued in the Supreme Court at various times under the income tax also, under the GST, the earlier laws, excise, service tax, etc. And there have been broader principles which the Supreme Court has laid down, that when the extended period of limitation has to be invoked and what care needs to be taken while invoking this extended period of limitation. Just on based on presumption assumptions, you cannot extend. There has to be proper material evidence available, and based on that only this period extended period of limitation can be invoked. The next point is whether cum tax or cum duty benefit can be availed in case of tax demand. So normally, if a demand is raised, suppose I receive a demand of say suppose 1 lakh rupees, now whether I can say that I can do an inclusive of tax, so whatever the amount, so turnover mismatch was say 10 lakh rupees, and whether I can say the difference in turnover is 10 lakhs, so I want to pay service tax, but I consider 10 lakhs as inclusive of tax, whether that is possible. So there have been the judgments under the excise regime also. We talked about go as per the contract. Whatever the contract between the parties is there, Maruti Udyog Supreme Court, Prompt and Smart Security Tribunal, Bangalore Tribunal, various other judgments, which says that go as per the contractual terms. Whatever the contractual terms are there, whether separately it has to be received or not, whether what was the case, that needs to be seen. Then payment of service tax GST under protest. So under the excise regime, there was a specific provision, Rule 233B of the Central Excise Rules 1994, which specifically provided for payment of service tax under protest. There is no specific provision under GST which talks about payment of GST under protest. But according to me, though there is no specific provision, we can always exercise our right to make any payment under protest. So just by filing DRC03 and making putting our remarks that this payment is under protest, or filing a letter with the jurisdiction officer that this payment is under protest, will amount to protest. And there have been various judgments on this case, whether protest under and in one of the judgments of the Chhattisgarh High Court also, they have mentioned that you make the payment under protest. Court is only saying that. Even there was one recent judgment of Jyoti Construction wherein whether the payment of with regard to the under protest payment, but this is a different case, but this GTL Infra, Chhattisgarh High Court, in that the mention of the under protest was there under GST. Now lastly, the issue is regarding responding to notices when matter is pending in court. So suppose there is a matter which is pending in court, suppose it's Safari Retreats case, wherein that Orissa High Court has said that you will get the ITC on immovable property, that whatever the construction of the immovable property, input credit can be claimed. Or in Mohit Minerals, the Gujarat High Court has said that you can, there is no GST on ocean freight. Now these matters are pending in Supreme Court. Now Supreme Court will decide the case. So I receive a similar notice. So whether I should file a reply, or I should say that based on this judgment, so normally what the course of action should be taken is that we should file a reply saying that this judgment is, we are awaiting this judgment, and based on that, we'll say. So we should not accept such liabilities in such cases. So this was about the issues which I feel a normal person should take into consideration while replying to notices. Then what should be the suggested approach for at the time for at the replying to the notices? One is that record the or note the date of receipt of the notice. If you are receiving a physical delivery or an email delivery, what is the date of receipt of the notice? Then check the time limit to reply the notice. Normally people don't check that. People just don't see what is the time limit for replying the notice, and they reply late, and there is no condonation given by the officer. Then in that case, the problem arises. Then read the show cause notice in a detailed manner. So normally the entire notice has to be read, whatever the grounds the officer has taken and what all things the officer has given. So what all the detailed show cause notice, read it in a proper manner, that these are the grounds which the officer has taken, and we have to counter each and every ground which has been taken in the show cause notice. So reading of the show cause notice is very essential. Whatever the grounds the officer has taken into consideration or facts he has mentioned, whether it is factually correct, that also needs to be seen. So all the facts, whatever the officer has mentioned in the show cause notice and whatever grounds he has taken, has to be analyzed in a proper manner. Once that is done, we have to discuss the issue with the client. So not, this is a suggested approach which we follow. I am just discussing that this is the issue. We discuss with the client that this is the issue. The officer has, these are the facts. The officer has decided in this way. What are the loopholes in our case, or whether our case is weak or our case is strong, whether we can collect further information to substantiate whatever grounds we have taken. So all this has to be done, analyzing the issues with the client, collection of further information to substantiate our claims, and then proceed to drafting of the response or the reply. When you are drafting the response or reply, have a very considerable approach. First, discuss whatever the facts are there, whatever the till now, whatever has happened, that initially the audit was done year 2000 or the GST audit, then the final audit report was issued or pre-consultation happened or any other notice, scrutiny notice was issued. So all those things, facts has to be disclosed. All the date-wise, whatever the facts has happened. Then check the validity of the notice, whether this notice is valid or not. Whether that person can issue that notice only, otherwise the time limit has expired or not. So that also has to be seen, that whether is the notice is valid. Even the jurisdiction also you can see that the proper person has issued the notice. So jurisdiction of the notice also, of the person who is issuing the notice has to be seen, whether he can issue notice to me or not. Because there are a lot of officers involved, state, center, etc. So who is my officer and who is issuing the notice, that has to be seen. And jurisdiction is a big area of dispute in the old regime also, that this is not in your jurisdiction, how can you issue notice, etc. Then go through the legal provisions, whatever the legal provisions are there in your case, any judicial developments which are happening, any judgment which have been passed in favor or against us, and how do you counter if the judgments are against us. Then make point by point counter, that whatever the grounds the officer has taken, I have to give a counter to that. So make a point by point counter, and what is a prayer, that this demand is not payable, please squash this demand, that this is not acceptable or disrespectfully denied, whatever be the case, and make a prayer. And last is a verification that whatever documents I have given, these are correct, etc. So this is the how the drafting of the response has to happen. And then when the response is drafted, then documentation, submission, annexures, case laws, page numbering, annexure numbering, these are all essential things which needs to be seen. And then ensure that you give a covering letter, then authorization to appear also. That is also very essential, that authority letter has to be given under section 116, authority letter, that I am, the client has authorized me to appear. Then if you are seeking extension, then file proper letters. Attend the personal hearing whenever the notice of personal hearing is coming. If you are not appearing, then file extension letters, etc. So this approach should be followed by issuing during the course of issuance of the notices. Ghanshyambhai, can I continue? The time is already over. There is one more section.
Raj, if you wish something very important, then you continue.
Okay.
Maybe next 2 minutes, if you can cover it up, then we close it accordingly.
Yeah, I'll briefly touch upon the issues, some recent amendments. And in 5 minutes, I'll try to cover.
Fine. Go ahead.
Okay. So the recent amendments related to GST and some circulars I'm discussing. One is regarding the tax wrongfully collected and paid to the government. So there is a provision, section 77 under the CGST Act and section 20 under the IGST Act, which says that if something is considered to be an intrastate supply, that it is subject to CGST, SGST, but I have paid IGST, then in that case, I have to pay the correct tax and the wrong tax will be refunded back. But the issue here was what is subsequently held. Whether the person who is paying the tax subsequently means found that this wrongly has been paid, or during by the tax officer during the proceedings. So the circular 162 has stated that it will be either of the case, when the taxpayer himself finds it out, or the officer during the proceedings he finds it out. Secondly is regarding the refund, that whether there is any time limit for claiming the such refund. So of the wrong type of tax which I have paid, whether there is any time limit. There was no specific time limit given, and therefore there was a lot of disputes on that. So recently there is an amendment in section rule 89(1A) has been inserted by notification 35, and that the time limit of 2 years of you can claim the refund of the wrong tax within 2 years from the payment of the correct tax. So whenever I pay the correct tax, from there 2 years time limit has to be computed. But what happens to the earlier period? So therefore that they have given the 2 years has to be counted from the issuance of this notification. And if you are issued a credit note, then there is no refund. For the wrong tax, if you issued a credit note, then there is no refund. Then calculation of the time limit for the debit notes. So that was also a big issue. There was an amendment in section 16(4) which delinked the issuance of credit note to the issuance of invoice. Time limit for availing the credit note, debit note from the issuance of invoice, and circular is issued in that regard only, sir, from how to compute the time limit for, because this amendment was effective from 1st of April, January 2021. So what about the notices, the debit note which are issued before 1st of this 1st of January 2021, and what about the debit note which are issued after 1st January 2021, that was covered in this. So there are illustrations given, you can go through it. Then the important circular and intermediary services, lot of people are facing this issue, and this circular 159 was issued that whenever this case is what falls under the definition of intermediary, and the CBSA has clearly said that there should be three parties to transact in the main supply. One arranges or facilitates the supply. There should be two distinct supply. One is the main supply of goods, supply of services, and then there's the ancillary supply, that is the agency. Intermediary should be agent, broker, or similar person. He should facilitate the main supply and does not provide the main supply. So he should be providing something other than the main supply. And subcontracting of a service is not intermediary. So this is a broader aspect. And they have given illustrations also to substantiate. This is a very good circular, and a lot of disputes might get resolved because of this circular. Then this was a typical circular, not required only, but there were a lot of disputes going on. Even the Gujarat High Court in the Linde Engineering under the service tax regime has issued an order. What was the issue? That for qualifying export of service, one of the condition is that the supplier and recipient should not be merely establishment of distinct person. Suppose that there is an Indian company which is separately incorporated and a foreign company, both are related companies, and they are providing services or so Indian companies exporting the services to the foreign company and they're related. Now holding and subsidiary, but they are established under legal, separate legal entities under the both the countries. So therefore any supply between them will be subject to GST. What was the contention of the departments? Because they're part of the same group, but that was not the case. They are not merely establishment of distinct person. That separate person itself, they're not HO or branch. That was not the case. If it is an HON branch, then export of service will not get, you will not get the benefit. But if they're separate companies incorporated in the jurisdiction countries, then this export of service benefit can be taken. And that is what has been clarified in the circular. This I'll skip. Now you can withdraw the refund application also. There is an option given to the applicants that they can withdraw the refund application. Then the filing of ITC 04 for job work cases, that has now changed to, depending on the turnover, it is half yearly. If above 5 crores, half yearly, and up to 5 crores annually. So only one ITC 04 needs to be filed for job work, goods dispatch or receive for job work purposes. Then this talks about Aadhaar authentication is mandatory in case of filing of revocation or cancellation of GST registration, refund applications, and bank account, PAN, Aadhaar linking. This is going to be a big thing, and then only the GST refunds will be given. Then there are certain recommendations of the GST Council which were made, and this is not yet notified, but these are the recommendation. One is on the interest on ineligible ITC. They have said that interest will be applicable only when the ITC is availed. So if availed and utilized, earlier it was availed or utilized, what was mentioned in section 73 also, availed or utilized, but here availed and utilized. So I'm availing ITC, but I'm not utilizing it, and I'm then reversing it, then there is no interest. That is what they have said. But this is not yet notified in the or amended in the act. Then I can transfer the cash balance between distinct persons. So suppose I have balance in CGST or balance in IGST, cash balance, electronic cash ledger in Gujarat, and I have also registration in Maharashtra. So I can directly transfer that from Gujarat to Maharashtra. I do not claim refund in Gujarat and then transfer it. Intra-head was already allowed. So if it is from CGST to SGST, SGST to IGST, in that same person was earlier allowed. But this is between two different persons. So that is a new thing. And but they are not allowed SGST of Gujarat to SGST of Maharashtra. That is not allowed. So what we can do is SGST of Gujarat to transfer to CGST of Gujarat, and then from CGST of Gujarat to CGST of Maharashtra, then you can transfer. So that route has to be adopted, but this is also will be notified. Then this rule 36.4 CGST rules, 5% of the invoices which are appearing, only that to the extent what was there. So 105%. That will be removed, and only in the invoices which are appearing in 2A will be allowed. So if your invoice is appearing in 2A or 2B, whatever the case, then only you will get the credit. This is to be notified from 1st of January, what I feel. and then auto computation of late fee for delayed filing of GSTR1. This was not happening currently on the portal, but now this will happen. Not yet started, but it will start in the next 2-3 months, I think so. And automatically in 3B, your late fees for delayed filing of GSTR1 appear. So quickly, I covered this. My apologies for that. But I hope I was able to justify the topic. Any questions I would like to take if the president permits and any questions. Otherwise, thank you so much for the patient listening. Thank you.
Raj, I think both of you had covered it so beautifully that no questions are coming up. Very elaborate talk by both the young lads. Keep it up.
Thank you.
So we close now, and it's over to Palomi Ben Dharamsi for her vote of thanks. Thank you, one and all.
Thank you, Ghanshyam Bhai. On behalf of KDOCA Association, I extend hearty gratitude and vote of thanks to both the eminent speakers, CA Raj Khona and CA Charvik Momaya, for enlightening us on the amendments of tax audit and GST. We thank them for sharing their practical instances for getting proper grip of the subject. I also thank the president of the association to select the appropriate topic at the appropriate time. And last but not the least, I thank all the participants here. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you, Palomi Madam. Thank you, Charvik Bhai. Everyone, thank you for joining.
Thank you.
Thank you.